Okay, gentlemen, it's the top of the hour. We'll do a call of order. I call this meeting of the San Diego chapter of the Sons of the American Revolution to order. Would you all please stand? Since Reverend DeLong is not with us today, I will lead the invocation. Almighty God, we ask your blessing on this chapter of the Sons of the American Revolution, as our purpose is to promote sound learning, true patriotism, and to further all that is good in our community. So we pray that you will strengthen our hands in all that we undertake, that we may serve our nation to your honor and glory. Amen. Color guard, would you advance the colors, please?
Present colors forward. March. Mark time. March. Color guard, halt. Left. Face. Present colors.
Patriot Hell, would you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please? You're muted, Patriot Hell.
I pledge allegiance to the flag. Republic for which it is
one nation under God, indivisible.
Compatriot Fagan, would you lead us in singing God Bless America?
Ready? God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the ocean, white with foam. God bless America, my home, we wait for.
Thank you.
Counterpoint.
Compatriot Henshaw, would you lead us in the pledge to the SAR?
We descendants, the heroes of the American Revolution,
by their sacrifices, established the United States of America. Reaffirm our faith in the principles of liberty and our constitutional republic, solemnly pledge to defend ourselves and them against every foe.
Thank you. And color guard, would you please retire the color?
Ready, two, right, face.
Thank you. Please be seated. We have a few guests today. Our first guest is Mrs. Judy Brooks, the director of the Red, White, and Blue Society, or CAR chapter, excuse me. Thank you, Judy, for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you again next month. Our next guest is our guest speaker. Today we have compatriot CASAR surgeon, compatriot Dr. Matthew Bowdish. Dr. Bowdish will be discussing George Washington's health history in a little bit. We also have a special guest with us. At last month's meeting, General Washington was otherwise detained. He has graciously arranged his schedule so he can speak to us today. General Washington held several key positions during our nation's, founding. He was a member of the House of Burgesses, a delegate to the Continental Congress, Commander-in-Chief of the Continental Army, as we all know, and Chancellor of the College of William and Mary, a post he held at the same time that he was President of the United States. It is with great pleasure that I introduce our esteemed guest, General George Washington. General, would you say a few words for our members?
Hi. Citizens of America, as you are placed in the most enviable condition, sole lords and proprietors of vast continents, you are now, from this period, to be considered as actors on a most conspicuous theater, which seems to be peculiarly designed by Providence for the display of human greatness and felicity. Here you are not only surrounded with everything that can contribute to the completion of private and domestic enjoyment, but heaven has crowned you with all its blessings by giving a fairer opportunity for political happiness than any other nation has ever been favored with. I would like to say a few words about something that is weighing heavily upon my heart at this moment. There is an opinion that parties in free countries are useful checks upon the administration of the government and serve to keep alive the spirit of liberty. This, within certain limits, is probably true, and in governments of a monarchical caste, patriotism may look with indulgence, if not with favor upon the spirit of party, but in those of a popular character in governments purely elective, it is a spirit not to be encouraged. From their national tendency, it is certain that there will always be enough of that spirit for every salutary purpose. And being constant danger of excess, the effort ought to be by the force of public opinion to mitigate and assuage it. A fire not to be quenched. It demands uniform vigilance to prevent its bursting into a flame, lest instead of warming it should consume. Thus, all my conclusions of political parties. However, each man shall be weighed upon by Providence with his own conscience to elect those seem to be what his own peculiar situation and circumstance for the good of the country. Thank you. I shall remain the Commander-in-Chief, George Washington.
Thank you, General Washington. We appreciate your words of wisdom.
And yes, may I take leave at this moment? I have urgent business at Mount Vernon. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Understood. Since our last meeting, we've added two new members to the San Diego chapter that I am pleased to introduce. The first is compatriot Gregory Martin Campbell, whose patriot ancestor was Thomas Campbell of the Pennsylvania Militia. And welcoming another new member, compatriot William Richard Mitchell Sr., whose patriot ancestor was William Morris Jr. and paid a supply taxes to support the cause. As a point to note, compatriot Mitchell is the grandfather of our compatriot Andrew Fagan and the father-in-law of Peter Fagan. Please welcome both of those gentlemen when you see them, hopefully in the not too distant future when we can have an in-person meeting. Last month we did something a little new. We did a little piece about history, and I've received a few calls and messages asking to continue that over the course of the next several meetings. So today we'll have a little bit of information on the on March history. On the 1st of March, the Articles of Confederation were finally ratified. The articles were signed by Congress and sent to the individual states for ratification on November 15th, 1777. And after 16 months of debate, they had what they wanted, but it took another 4 years for everyone to, for all the states to sign on for it. On March 2nd, General Washington ordered American artillery forces to begin bombarding Boston from their positions at Lechmere Point, which is northwest of the city center. British General William Howe realized Boston was indefensible and decided to leave the city on March 7th, 1776. On March 4th, the first session of Congress was held in New York City as the Constitution took effect. However, of the 22 senators and 59 representatives called to represent the 11 states who had ratified the document, only 9 senators and 13 representatives showed up to begin negotiations on the amendment. So they had to wait another day for other members to arrive so they could have a quorum. On March 5th of the same month, on a cold, snowy night in 1770, a mob of American colonists gathered at the British Customs House in Boston and began taunting the British soldiers guarding the building. And I think we all know what happened during that event. John Adams and Josiah Quincy agreed to defend the soldiers who shot the crowd, leaving 5 dead and 3 injured. And only 2 of those soldiers were found guilty. On the 9th, after successfully capturing British positions in Louisiana and Mississippi, Spanish General Bernardo de Galvez, commander of the Spanish forces in North America, turned his attention to the British-occupied city of Pensacola, Florida, and began a 2-month siege. On March 15th, General George Washington made a surprise appearance at an assembly of army officers at Newburgh, New York, to calm growing frustration and distrust of what had been openly expressing towards Congress for failing to honor its promise to pay and reimburse for expenses, like paying for their troops' food and clothing. And 234 years ago today, Benjamin Franklin and Silas Deane and Arthur Lee presented themselves to King Louis the 16th as official representatives of the US. Louis was skeptical of the fledgling Republic, but his dislike of the British eventually overcame any concerns that he had. And on the 22nd, Parliament passed the Stamp Act to pay for debt for the new territories. This March seemed to be the month of acts for the British, as they also imposed the Quartering Act, the Coercive Acts, and many others. And on the 31st, Abigail Adams urged her husband and others not to forget the women's rights as part of every, as they were part of every act of rebellion as their husbands. Unfortunately, it took 20 years for women to be become recognized. Okay, now with that, I have the privilege of announcing today's guest speaker, compatriot Dr. Matthew Bowdish. Dr. Bowdish is a board certified allergist and clinical immunologist in the Sacramento area and has over 18 years of medical experience in the field. Dr. Bowdish has experience in environmental allergies and food and drug allergies than any other specialist in his area. He graduated from Northeastern Ohio University's and the College of Medicine in medical school in 2003. It is my privilege to introduce or to invite Dr. Bowdish to speak. Matt, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much. Appreciate the opportunity to come. Well, I appreciate coming to be able to speak to you all. Actually, I used to live in San Diego for a couple of years before medical school. I was living in Hillcrest and working in the Torrey Pines area at a biotech company there. And so it's always exciting to catch up with friends in San Diego. Let's see if I can set this up. Can everybody see everything okay? So I'm going to be talking a little bit today about colonial medicine, as well as George Washington's health history in particular. And I think it's an interesting talk and timely in some ways. And it also gives us a little insight into some of the health issues that our ancestors suffered from. I don't know if you all have ever done this. You know, we're all amateur genealogists. Some of us are professional genealogists. And we create our family trees as we go through and researching our ancestors. And as a physician, I've been very interested in the health history of my family, not only for my own medical genetics, but also just to see how disease affected them over the years. And so a few years ago, I created, and now I'm updating, this cause of death family tree. And I don't know if anybody else has ever done this before, but it's a kind of interesting insight. You know, just looking at my own family tree, you can see some of my recent generations. I've had ancestors who have committed suicide during very debilitating illnesses. So something to keep in mind. I also have a number of ancestors who have suffered from diseases brought on by smoking. And so that's affected my own decision not to smoke tobacco products. And so you can kind of get a sense of, you know, your family's history, even just, you know, the fact of my own native Californianism in a way. I'm a fifth generation Californian. My ancestors arrived in Los Angeles in the 1870s and 1880s. And the reason they arrived there is because, you know, they had respiratory ailments and they had to get out of the Midwest at that time. Sorry, somebody have a question?
Is the yellow box around there?
Ernest, you have a question? Oh, muting. Okay. And so, you know, you can learn a lot just about your own family history as well as just the history of the U.S. by going back and looking at some of these illnesses. And when you go back far enough, you start realizing that healthcare a couple hundred years ago was obviously very different than what it is today. At that time, most people received their healthcare at home. And who was the primary care provider at that time? It was mom. So treatments included nutritional and herbal remedies, even minor surgery. Often those were done at home. And often family members had medical books. There was a famous book called The English Housewife that was essentially a manual for women back going all the way into the early 1600s. And the whole first chapter was all about how women should take care of the family health. And it had a variety of different recipes for tinctures and other herbal remedies for various diseases at the time. Physicians themselves were actually very limited in number back in those days, and hospitals were almost non-existent unless you were in a big city. When healthcare providers were around, they were often taught by the writings of men who came before them thousands of years ago. Hippocrates and Galen were some of the big physicians that influenced healthcare all the way up until the mid 1800s, actually. And Galen was one of the big proponents of medicine that lasted up until that time. And there was this idea that Galen took from Aristotle that just as there are four elements in the world, earth, air, fire, and water, there are also four humors that they corresponded with in the human body: phlegm, black bile, yellow bile, and blood. And therefore, all disease was basically a lack of homeostasis within the body. And treatments at that time basically were set up to put those four humors back into balance. And we see this with a variety of different teachings at the time, some of which have even persisted to today. These are just some charts that are kind of been modernized with English language, talking about the various four humors and relating them to even different types of personality types within human beings, and basically looking at all these four humors as ways to treat disease. And when treatments occurred, often they were trying to get rid of these kind of bad humors within the body. Techniques such as cupping and blistering, the use of poultices and cataplasms, and even purgatives and meds were commonly used. With cupping, basically what you're doing is you're heating up a glass vial of some sort, And that allows for air to kind of be sucked down in a vacuum, and it sucks up the tissue. Sometimes you would take the tissue underneath and you would abrade it with either a lancet or some sort of scratching implement that would allow plasma to come up and basically pull things out of the body that were bad and were causing disease. In the same way, you would use some sort of noxious substance, like an irritating substance on the skin, and then wrap a bandage around it for the idea that it would pull out some of these bad humors. And purgatives, we know about emetics and laxatives. I'm not going to go into depth on that. But where do you see these things today? I mean, do we still use these? Have we, you know, kind of gotten past some of these old ancient treatments? Well, no. Actually, we see this, you know, even back in the 2016 Olympics. Here's Michael Phelps. These bruises on his shoulders were the result of cupping. The idea was that you're drawing blood into the muscles and allowing the muscles to heal faster. So these techniques in many ways are still used, if not for the same reason, often for other reasons. And another popular technique of the day was venesection or bleeding. These pictures, I actually, the main picture below, you can see a bleeding implement here called a fleam that I've put another photo up in the right corner because it's kind of difficult to see. I actually have one of these fleams in my possession. I bought one a few years ago. This is from the 1820s, and it's actually a veterinary fleam, but it's the same type of an idea. The idea is basically that you're taking bad blood out of the body during these disease processes. And if you look at the picture closely, you can see a couple of brass pans. These were usually filled with hot water that would allow some of the veins to become engorged. And then you would take these various fleams or bleeding implements, the little boxes are some modern versions of fleams that were from the mid 1800s. You would cut the veins and allow the blood to come out. And then that would get rid of these bad humors. And that becomes important with George Washington. We're going to talk about that towards the end of the talk. And let me tell you, there are a lot of little blood vessels in the body that you can bleed from. So this is a medical textbook from 1528, German textbook, and it shows all the various locations of veins that you can use for bleeding processes. Even with all of this amazing medical treatment at the time, you'd be surprised, but actually life was short, nasty, and brutish. This is a morbidity and mortality schedule from London back in the 1730s. It's actually 1732, the same year that George Washington was born. And you can see the various diseases that people suffered from, obviously with a predilection towards infectious disease at the time, everything from smallpox being a big killer to consumption, to various kind of secondary diseases usually brought on by infections like convulsions, you know, basically seizures, probably febrile seizures, various forms of heart disease. There's even the King's Evil on here that killed 19 different people. That's scrofula, which is a tubercular disease. And at the very bottom of this chart, it's interesting, but it shows the number of people who were born and died during that year. And you can see down at the very bottom, it's very interesting. Well, number of younger people died. There were even a lot of folks that lived well into their 80s, 90s, and even 100s in London that year. A couple people living to 105 years of age, if you can imagine that, in London in 1730s. The other thing to keep in mind at this time is look at all the kids under age 2 that died, 9,500 out of that total number. So that's one of the reasons why life expectancy was so low, is because lots and lots of kids died as infants or toddlers. Often this was the time before mass immunization, before antibiotics, before things like clean water and clean food. And so we had a lot of kids dying, and this would drive down the overall life expectancy. And that becomes important later on in our talk too. Okay, now we go back to George Washington. So simple question for the crowd. What physical characteristics do we associate with George Washington? Anyone?
He was tall.
He was, yeah, he was tall. He was about 6'1".
He had bad teeth.
He had bad teeth, right? And there's often a lot of tales about wooden teeth that he had, which was not true, but we'll talk a little bit about that in a bit, in a couple of slides from now. What else?
Smallpox or something similar to that.
Yeah, he did have smallpox. And we're going to talk a little bit about that. That becomes important in the picture coming up here. I'll show you. Others? He was a very adept person physically. Like somebody mentioned, he was tall, but he was also very athletic. He was said to be a very good horseman. He was also a good dancer. So he was a guy who would, you know, basically be a big, strong, athletic dude in his day. And you can see this from some of the pictures that we have of him. This is a picture about the time of the American Revolution, painted by Charles Wilson Peale. All of these are portraits where he actually sat for these paintings. And you can see he looks kind of like a big, you know, burly dude, a little bit ruddy in the cheeks. Here's another picture of him, almost even a little chunky. This is Joseph Wright in 1783, towards the end of the war. Here's a picture of Washington later on, kind of the elder statesman. And you can see also relatively strong personality. But when we think about Washington, or when you think about Washington in the future, the portrait that I really want you to remember is this one by William Williams from 1794. Again, it was just a few years before his death. He's the elder statesman. It's about the same time that this one by Wirt Muller was done. And it was a painting done by a fellow Mason. And, you know, there may be something to this idea that Masons, you know, view each other and view themselves as who they really are. But this painting is probably the most accurate painting you'll ever see of George Washington. And it takes a little bit of time to look at it. But I want you to take a look at this close up. And actually, I have this a print of this painting right up here. Where is it? In my office. And you can actually buy a lithograph of it from the Alexandria Masonic Temple. They have the original that's still hanging in the temple to this day. So what do you see in this picture? This painting, this is a painting. Remember, there's no photography back then.
He looks tired.
He looks tired? Why does he look tired?
The furrows on his brow.
He's got furrows on his brow. Look, he's got crow's feet. Have you ever seen a painting like this where you see somebody's crow's feet? This is like well before the days of airbrushing things. Airbrushing wasn't a thing. You wouldn't brush it in to begin with.
A mole.
What else do you see?
This right ear.
A mole? Yeah, so that's right. So right at the right ear, is kind of near the where the earlobe starts coming out. There's a mole. It could be just a regular mole. It could even be, some sort of skin cancer. Look closely. Now, you guys are now the amateur dermatologists. So what else do you see? Look really closely.
Up on his forehead, it looks like there's some scarring up there.
Yeah, there's actually sun damage. Really typical sun damage that you would see from somebody that spent most of their life in the sun. There's actually a couple little veins up here, not rosacea probably, but just from sun damage there. There's a couple little dark, you know, spots that probably have melanin in them from that. Anything else? Well, I don't know how good your screen is here, but can you see, I don't know, can you see my cursor, by the way, moving around the screen?
Yeah.
Yes.
Is that rosacea?
What's this right here? And what are these over here? Those are pock marks from smallpox. We mentioned smallpox earlier. The painter actually painted these pock marks on his skin so you can see them. What about over here on his cheek? What's that?
Some kind of an indentation.
Yeah, it's an old scar. Yeah. So as a young man, he had a dental abscess and it got so bad that they had to cut through the side of his cheek to access his dental abscess, his tooth abscess. Oh. And so that's a scar. And if you look at some of the older other paintings of him, you'll see the scar right there. There's the same scar. You'll see the scar right here. So other people, you know, some people did show it, but not to the same, you know, depth as this. He's got a 5 o'clock shadow. If you look really, really closely, you can see some little skin lesions around his eyes. See those little bumps right there and right there? Some people have called those syringiomas, but usually we see those underneath, but he's got something right there too. Sometimes they're just little keratoses, like buildup of skin protein. He's got a little nevus up here on his forehead. That could be a little bit of sun damage or an old scar. I mean, it's pretty amazing. Oh, here's another one of those smallpox lesions on the side of his nose here. I mean, just imagine how in depth this painter was sitting there looking at Washington to be able to paint something like this. And again, if you're looking at it closely as a dermatologist, you might be able to pick up some of these other findings. So it's pretty amazing. So whenever we see a new patient in our clinic, you have to fill out all this paperwork and give your insurance card and, start filling out the pages and pages of paperwork. One of the things we look at is the family medical history. That's often an indicator of what can happen with your current patient, just like I was showing you the cause of death tree earlier on. And we know some of the health history of the Washington family, not a lot, but his direct ancestors, his great grandfather was John Washington. That was the immigrant ancestor who came from Essex in England to Virginia in the 1650s. And he died in his 40s of respiratory ailments. Now, 46 seems pretty young to us. Now I'm 50, so I'm past that. But 46 in 1600s, Virginia was actually pretty good when you're looking at a life expectancy of somewhere around 25 to 30 during those years. So he lived much longer than what you would normally expect. His paternal great-grandmother, Anne Pope, she died at age 33. Unfortunately, we don't know all the health history, especially the ladies at that time. Grandfather Lawrence Washington died at age 37 from respiratory diseases. So we see that this is a family that is affected by respiratory disease, just like many people of the day. Another grandmother, Mildred Warner, died in her 30s of unknown causes. Father Augustine Washington died at 48. He had gout of the stomach. That could have been some sort of ulcer in the stomach or even a stomach cancer of some sort. It's kind of a, relapsing pain in the stomach. And then his mother, Mary Washington, died at 81 of breast cancer. So even, again, people in these days when life expectancy was not as long as it is today, there were many people that were able to survive all of these different diseases and live well into, what we normally think about as a typical life expectancy of today. Washington's early years, he had a number of different diseases that were typical of young people in colonial America. By age 15, he had measles, mumps, and black canker, which is diphtheria. These are all things that we get immunized for today. He, qualified as a surveyor during his education years in the 1740s and early 1750s. He was out surveying lands around Virginia, especially in Alexandria, some of those swampy areas. So not surprisingly, he acquired the ague, which is malaria. He had several bouts of malaria throughout his life. Many of them were treated with Jesuit bark, which was a quinine-containing product. Quinine of the day was one of the best and most expensive therapies for malaria. It actually was used for a variety of other ailments as well. And unfortunately, it would cause a lot of side effects. It could cause severe hearing loss. It could cause infertility. It could cause a variety of other things. And being on large doses of these medicines often caused a lot of side effects. Now, to say that his older half-brother, Lawrence Washington, was a huge impact on Washington's life, I think is understated. George Washington really modeled his entire life after Lawrence. Lawrence was a planter. He was a member of the House of Burgesses. He was a very accomplished soldier. He fought in a war, called the War of Jenkins' Ear. It was in the Caribbean against the Spanish. And he fought under a gentleman by the name of Edward Vernon. Mount Vernon is actually named after Lawrence's commanding officer during the War of Jenkins' Ear. And Washington, you see, as he goes up through his own life, he models many of his own activities on Lawrence, becoming involved in the organized colonial militia, becoming a politician, and so forth. And he also spent a lot of time with Lawrence. And one of the kind of penultimate experiences in Washington's life is when the two went to Barbados in November of 1751. Lawrence had terrible issues with tuberculosis. Sorry, are you trying to ask question? Peter? No? Lawrence had a terrible case of tuberculosis and was quite ill from tuberculosis towards his later years. And so they left for Barbados to basically get out of the area of Virginia where all this bad air was and go to Barbados to try to recuperate. Shortly after arriving in Barbados, the Washingtons were invited to dinner at the plantation of a very famous Bajan man by the name of Jeffrey Gedney. Actually, the Gedney family is still quite active in Barbados. They still own one of the oldest rum distilleries in the Caribbean and produce a very almost toxic, high octane form of rum nowadays. at that time, they were very stately folks, of course, and they invited the Washingtons to come for dinner. And later, when George Washington wrote about this experience, he had said that they had known that the family had smallpox, but they went anyway, basically, because it was rude to turn them down. About 2 weeks later, George Washington developed smallpox himself, and it was a rather severe case. He was laid up in a bed in Barbados for about 3 weeks before eventually recovering. So it probably was a relatively severe form of smallpox. We don't know for sure, but you know, people in bed that long usually are not don't have a mild case. Unfortunately, you know, Lawrence after Washington kind of improved in terms of his own health with smallpox, he went back to Virginia. Lawrence stayed for several more weeks before returning later on, but Lawrence was not long for this world because, you know, in the next year, he actually died early in 1752. During the French and Indian War, we know a little bit about Washington's health. He was serving again in the organized militia. Some people say that he actually started the French and Indian War. There's some controversy around that, but regardless, he was serving under Major General Edward Braddock. And one of his famous expeditions was to capture the French Fort Duquesne near essentially where Pittsburgh is now. And along the way, he developed a case of bloody flux, which is basically dysentery, so bloody diarrhea. And he was left behind to be treated with a variety of different medications, including Dr. James Powders, which was a combination of salt, mercury, and the bark being that Jesuit bark we talked about before, that was a source of quinine. And he was able to recuperate after a couple of days and catch up with the Braddock's column. They weren't making particularly good headway through a very dense forested area. And he was able to serve alongside Braddock at the Battle of Monongahela, which, you know, was a terrible defeat for the colonial British troops. I think it was something like 1,300 men were in that battle, and close to 900 were either killed or wounded in that battle. It was pretty much a bloodbath. I think the French only lost about 50 people between them and some of the Native American allies. Regardless, Washington had two horses shot out from under him. He evidently had four bullet holes in his uniform, and yet somehow he escaped unscathed from that. Major General Braddock was not so fortunate. He was shot in the wrist and the lungs, possibly by his own troops during a retreat. He was essentially mortally wounded on the battlefield. Washington was able to recover his body and take command. Actually, Braddock gave him his sash on the spot to basically signify that he was now leading these troops. He was able to move Braddock off of the battlefield, but Braddock died about 4 days later and was buried along the roadside on the way back to Virginia. And so it was kind of a experience for Washington because it really cemented his reputation as an amazing soldier. However, during the years around and after the French and Indian War, he also was afflicted by a variety of different ailments. He went through recurrent episodes of malaria, like I said before. He was brooding, sometimes almost going into depressive states. He fell in love with a married woman by the name of Sally Carey Fairfax of the Fairfax, Virginia family. He had flux with pleurisy and fever for approximately 4 months and really was ridiculed by many of his compatriots. other soldiers and officers. And some people think that he really developed a dislike of some of the British organized army officers at this time because of the way he was treated by them. Regardless, he went through and recovered. He took over the reins of Mount Vernon. He became involved with a variety of different planting activities. And one of the big parts of taking care of his plantation was to take care of the people that worked there, both the ones that were paid and the ones that were enslaved. He imported medical textbooks from England. He learned to practice medicine on not only in the enslaved people at Mount Vernon, but also his own family members. He learned to bleed on his stepdaughter, Patsy. So she was one of the first people that he practiced venesection on. He set up at least two, if not three, infirmaries on the grounds of Mount Vernon. He was one of the first in Virginia to inoculate his enslaved folks for smallpox. He had read about it from various European journals, and this was a very controversial subject of the day. It was actually illegal in Virginia for quite some time. Thomas Jefferson, as a young man, actually traveled to Philadelphia so he could be inoculated for smallpox when it was actually illegal for him to get the shot while he was in Virginia. And so some people will actually call him Dr. Washington because of some of his experiences there. Now, during the Revolution, we don't know a lot about Washington's health history because it was really kept as a national secret. It was a state secret in a way. So we have some experience in some writings about how he had a really bad tonsillitis when he was at Morristown, Virginia. But we really don't know a heck of a lot about him during the Revolution itself. One of the things that I thought was funny was when I was preparing this talk, I came across this paper. It was part of a bigger article on colonial health history at the time. And this was basically a intake history and physical for Washington, as if he'd been trying to join the Continental Army, as just any other soldier does whenever they try to join our military. They go through a history and physical, and it lists various ailments. You can see back here, malaria, 1749, smallpox, 1751, TB, influenza, malaria again, dysentery, and malaria again, dysentery again. And it's kind of funny, you can see the doctor who's doing the history and physical, Benjamin Rush here. It says at the very end, subject cannot be recommended for active duty in the field because he has all these different diseases. And to be honest with you, all of our ancestors who served in the American Revolution had probably very similar health histories to Washington at the time. They were all survivors. You had to be to kind of get through that time. And one of the early battles within the Revolution kind of tells you some of the importance of disease had on the troops. The Siege of Quebec happened in 1775. General John Thomas and U.S. Army or American Army forces marched all the way up through Quebec to the gates of Quebec City. There, Sir Guy Carleton was held up, and General Thomas laid siege to the city. However, the siege went on, and they were unable to capture it, and soon disease set in. The siege itself, the American troops were plagued by smallpox at the time, and General John Thomas actually died of smallpox during that expedition. So because of that, in 1776, Washington ordered inoculation of smallpox for all Continental troops. And because of that, probably saved many of their lives and may have even affected the outcome of the American Revolution. We know a little bit about the medical history of Valley Forge, and I think that also explains what our ancestors went through this time from a medical standpoint. And it's pretty grim. 10,000 troops arrived in December of 1777. First, they were in these makeshift tents before being put in these 14-foot by 16-foot huts. I don't know if any of you have been to Valley Forge today, but you can see these huts and you can walk around them. And it's amazing to me that each of them held 12 soldiers in each of those small little huts. 4,000 of those troops initially didn't have any blankets. 2,500 never had a blanket during the time they were at Valley Forge, and 30% suffered disease. And the diseases were the typical ones at the time, not only cold-related diseases, but also smallpox, typhoid, typhus, and pneumonia. And about 25% of the troops that arrived at Valley Forge during that winter died in Valley Forge. It's pretty amazing to think about. Now, one of the things we talked about before was dental hygiene. And Washington did have a number of dental implements. The pictures on the right there were implements that were found at Mount Vernon in the 1790s. So these are ones that the Washington family had used. Washington had a variety of dental issues over the time. I mentioned the abscess tooth before. He always blamed his dental issues on cracking walnuts as a child, but it probably had to do with more hygiene-related issues as well as bacterial problems. His first tooth was pulled at age 22, and by the time he became president, he only had one natural tooth left. And this brings up some of the issues related to dentures with General Washington. He never had dentures that were made of wood. Typically, they were ones that were fashioned from whalebone, hippopotamus teeth. Sometimes he actually had human teeth in his dentures, and there are receipts for him purchasing 9 teeth for 122 shillings from the enslaved individuals at Mount Vernon. So they were used in a variety of these different dentures, and sometimes they were actually used in dental implant surgery at the time. You can imagine how difficult that is to go through nowadays. Just imagine being in the 1780s and 1790s and getting a dental implant. He had a variety of different dentists. Probably the most famous one was Paul Revere, but his other main dentist during the Revolution was actually a French dentist that came over with French forces. And his teeth were a big issue for him because these dentures did not fit well. Most of the time, folks with dentures had a lot of problems in these days. These were not the dentures of nowadays with various sealants and adhesives and everything. His teeth clicked when he talked. He did not smile because of this. And so he had this impression as a somewhat dour person, and probably a big part of it had to do with his dental issues. Now, during his presidency, he had a variety of health issues too. He actually developed an abscess on his leg in 1789. This was about 6 months after his inauguration. He came ill with fever, chills, cramps, and he had this large abscess on his leg. He underwent surgery and he ended up being in bed for about 6 weeks recovering from this. He also again had these chronic health issues with recurrent bouts of malaria. He also developed conjunctivitis and pneumonia at the time. And overall, he was in bed and unable to perform his duties for about 3 months of his presidency, which is interesting. We talk so much about presidential health nowadays and whether somebody has a stroke or is, you know, falling down or different things. You know, you can see the president, you can imagine what the press would have been like back then with Washington. So eventually Washington completes his terms and he heads home to Mount Vernon, hoping he's gonna have a rest of his life living in peace and tranquility and working the fields and surveying the lands that he not only had before the war, but also were granted to him after the war. And he goes back in March 1797 to Mount Vernon to basically enter retirement. Unfortunately, it wasn't too much longer after that that he suffered an illness that would end his life. And so in the last few slides, we're going to talk about that illness and hopefully learn some kind of important ideas from it. So Thursday, December 12th, he was doing what he normally do, out inspecting his lands. He got involved in this really bad snow, hail and freezing rainstorm. That night he arrived at home late, did not change in out of his clothing before supper. In the evening, he developed a sore throat and dysphonia. So he retired early, noting that he was suffering from a cold. The next morning he awoke, he had more issues with a sore throat. He had developed dysphonia. Dysphonia is our fancy term for hoarseness of the voice or some weird noises coming out of the throat. He developed a severe cough and spent most of the day lounging around the house and eventually retired early. On Saturday, December 14th, he woke up very early in the morning and he knew he was in trouble. He had a sore neck. He had a hard time moving his neck. He developed a high fever and he had a condition called stridor or a symptom called stridor. Stridor is a upper airway wheeze and suggests some sort of obstruction in the upper airway. So he was breathing with very much distress, kind of like that. Martha obviously was very concerned. She called for his secretary, Tobias Lear. Tobias Lear tended to him for a few hours. And eventually Tobias Lear called the farm overseer, George Rawlings, early in the morning, who came in. George had been trained by Washington to let blood as well as to be involved with various medical treatments of the day. Rawlings let blood and applied blisters. He pulled off about a half a quart despite Martha's objections. Martha was not a fan of venesection, even in this day. He also gave Washington a formula of molasses, butter, and vinegar, and they noted no improvement after watching him for a short period of time. Now, I also want to give you an idea of when we're going through this process and these physicians and various people are seeing him, what kind of strains were put on Washington's health. So this is a picture of the total blood volume for a 70 kilogram man. Now, Washington was probably a little bit bigger than that, but roughly we all have about 5 quarts or a little over 5 quarts of blood as men in our bodies. So George Rawlings pulls off that first half quart of blood. 9 o'clock that morning, friend and Surgeon General, Dr. James Craik arrives in Mount Vernon. Craik was a Scottish immigrant. He actually served with Washington during the French and Indian War and also the American Revolution. He assessed Washington, saw that he was very ill, and recommended another quart of bloodletting. Still no improvement. 2 hours later, Craik bled yet another quart of blood. He applied blisters to Washington's neck. Obviously, he was having stridor still at that time. And he gave him a gargle of sage tea and vinegar. And he also gave him an enema. And again, they're trying to basically remove these bad humors from Washington. And they're thinking in the paradigms of their day that Washington's sick, he's not getting better. Let's do more of what we think is going to help him. So now we're down approximately half of Washington's blood volume, right? Martha, not being dumb, asked for second opinion. She calls a couple of other physicians, and two other physicians arrive later that afternoon, Dr. Elisha Dick, who was a young physician in the area, later became involved with Maryland politics, and another older physician, Gustavius Brown. Now, we have a saying in medicine that the prognosis of the patient is inversely correlated with the number of doctors in the room. So if you have a lot of doctors around, it's not good. So obviously, three doctors of their day debating about what's going on with Washington. The two older doctors, Gustavius Brown and James Craik, recommended yet another quart of blood be drawn off of Washington. Obviously, if he's not getting better yet and he's still got these bad humors, let's bleed him some more and see if that helps. The younger upstart Elisha Dick had read about this entity involved with stridor called epiglottitis, and a treatment for it that had been tried successfully in France called a tracheotomy. A tracheotomy is basically where you punch a small hole in the bottom of the front of the throat to bypass some sort of upper airway obstruction. And so the idea was that you would open up the bottom of the, or part of the trachea and the bottom of the voice box and see if you can actually get Washington breathing on a normal level. This had never been done in colonial America before. This was something that was thought up of by French physicians, and the two older doctors, Craik and Brown, basically overruled Elisha Dick and said, there's no way that George Washington is gonna be the guinea pig for this procedure for the first time it happens in America. So again, now they've pulled off 3.5 quarts of his blood volume. And you can imagine what would happen to you if you didn't have enough blood volume to be able to do things like perfuse the important organs like your heart and your brain, let alone all the strain that puts on those organs to be able to perfuse other areas of the body. And again, what we think he had now was this condition called acute epiglottitis. It's hard to say. The epiglottis is a little valve that goes over your trachea, the top part of your trachea. So when you swallow food or swallow water, it doesn't go down into your lungs. When people get diseases, especially diseases like diphtheria or upper airway diseases like Streptococcus pneumoniae, they can get this tissue becoming very swollen. And instead of having this patent airway you see here on the left with this x-ray, you have a blockage. So there's no air going through. And if there's just a little bit of air through, that's what causes the stridor. So this could have been epiglottitis. It could have been several other diseases too. There are a lot of diseases that caused abscesses in the back of the throat, but some sort of infectious thing that he was suffering from. Probably wasn't a cancer, because that would be more of a progressive long-term thing. Regardless, Saturday afternoon, Washington calls Lear to review his wills. He obviously knows he's in trouble. One will is tossed into the fireplace. Another one is saved. And he knows that he's not long for this world. So at some point he says, okay, we need to start, you know, calling this off. 5 o'clock, changes into his bed clothes. There are some cataplasms and blisters that the doctors deploy, but at sometime in the early evening, he basically asks for all interventions to stop. And what does he do? He thanks his doctors. He says, doctor, I die hard, but I'm not afraid to go. I believe from my first attack that I should not survive. My breath cannot last long. And like many things in his life, Washington was right. Because about 10:22 p.m. that night, he dies with his last words being, "Tis well." And I think it's important, well, before we get there. So at that time, there was also this thought that when you first died, you were not really dead. You were almost in a sense of suspended animation. You'll hear stories where people will put air tubes in their caskets or little ways like a string with a bell on it. So if you're stuck down in your casket and you somehow wake up from death, you can ring that bell or call out for people and they'll come and unbury you. And so there's this idea of suspended animation. So because other doctors in the area had also read about tracheotomy, one of the famous doctors in Virginia around DC area, William Thornton, sent a message to Martha on that Monday asking that he could perform a post-mortem tracheotomy and maybe bring Washington back to life. But again, Martha knew that this was not going to happen. And of course, a variety of different recriminations followed. Eventually, I mean, years and years later, Elisha Dick was probably proven to be correct in all of this, but it was a huge political scandal at the time. And I think, you know, understanding Washington's health history is important for a variety of ways. Number one, obviously, he was affected by many diseases throughout his lifetime. And his medical history is really the same story of our ancestors' medical history. And so when you read, maybe you're lucky to have a pension document that mentions illness somewhere, or you're lucky to have a family history that mentions illness, you can go back and you can look at a lot of these health issues and understand what our ancestors were going through. They were the very same things that Washington was going through. Many of these diseases affect people from all walks of life. And I think the other important thing to remember about George Washington's health history is that his demise could have probably been averted. You know, he was older, he was in his 60s. He, you know, might not have lived a heck of a lot longer. He could have been sick and ill with something else in another couple of months, but he was a robust, strong guy. And it didn't help him that his doctors took out 75% of his blood volume. And it's important to understand in medicine that when we do things as physicians, we can cause harm just as we can also help with healing. And so I think it's important to know George Washington's health history to understand that just because something is settled science doesn't really mean that it's settled science. And so that's the main part of the talk. I just want to draw attention to one person, David Kerfman, number three here, wrote an article on the Founders and Patriots website on the medical history of George Washington. And this was really my impetus for taking that material and expanding it into this talk today. And he died in the early 2000s. He was also Surgeon General of the Sons of the American Revolution and was a totally amazing man. I was never fortunate to meet him. He was a physician as well. And I just want to give a little hat tip to David Kerfman for inspiring me to give this talk. And I can take any questions if you want to ask questions.
Yeah, Dr. Bowdish. Towards the beginning of the presentation, you showed a chart that had the humors and, you know, that kind of, yeah, the circular one.
Yep. There
you go. Yeah, I noticed there's signs of the zodiac as well. Did that play into the whole thing too?
I think the zodiac came a little bit later. I mean, that wasn't part of Galen's original ideas on the four humors, but I think it's a chart that, you know, probably came later on, more in the Middle Ages, where, you know, some of the signs were more important for some of these health issues.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Other questions?
What I find very interesting is the relationship between Washington's health and those of our ancestors.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, I'm fortunate. I have one pension document that talks about some health history issues with one of my ancestors who was in the Revolution, and really about like a bloody flux. So very similar to what Washington had. I am also in the Society of the Cincinnati and am involved with admitting people to the society. And one of the eligibility requirements for ancestors was that you have to serve for 3 years unless you died in service to your country. And we admitted a man who was a descendant of, he was a nephew of an ancestor who had died about 1 month into service, which was interesting. And he had died after a smallpox inoculation. And so he was inoculated by the doctor just under Washington's orders. And at that time, inoculation carried with it about a 2-3% risk of death. So you can imagine our vaccines now, and we talk about the side effects, but we're talking 2-3% of the people that had a smallpox inoculation died of smallpox. Now that was better than somewhere between 25-90%, depending upon what form of smallpox you acquired. But still, people were that desperate to avert themselves from getting smallpox that they would take the risk of 2 out of 100 or maybe 3 out of 100 people dying. And so you get this sense of like what kind of a disease smallpox was at the time, to where people would inoculate the entire Continental Army, or a siege to Quebec would end because you had a smallpox outbreak, or that you had members of your family. I don't know if you've ever seen the HBO series on John Adams, but it has a scene with a smallpox inoculation where Abigail Adams basically is inoculating the children, herself and the children, for smallpox. And it's a little gruesome, but at the same time, it's pretty amazing to think about our ancestors' health histories that way.
Barry, is this recording going to be available through the website?
It'll be on YouTube, which you can get to through the website, yes.
Okay, would you be kind enough to send a link out to us?
Sure, certainly.
And if you want a copy of the talk, I'd be happy to send Barry a PDF copy if people want to look at it later on.
Yes, please.
This has been really enlightening, and I'm very grateful for you to spend the time putting this work together.
Oh, my pleasure. It's amazing material, and I find it all very fascinating. Obviously, being a genealogist and family historian and just medical historian, it's just a very fascinating bit of history.
One of the things I'm going to do is try and look up the cause of death of my ancestors.
It can be a little challenging. I mean, obviously, looking at the death certificates is a big part of that, but death certificates stop after you go back a certain amount. So sometimes you can get clues other ways, but it's a kind of fascinating way to look at your family history.
Certainly.
Also.
Yeah, my Patriot ancestor died at the age of 99 years and 8 months. So I'm assuming it was just old age that mm-hmm. got to him. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and one of my ancestors who I joined with, I did a supplemental on, Esquire Phillips, was a private in some of the Connecticut lines and the militia. He died, I think he was 96 when he died.
Yeah.
It was a pretty good run.
Mm-hmm.
And that actually, if you look, my great-grandmother, who died of pneumonia at age 99 and a half, she was just 6 months from her 100th birthday, she's in that same Phillips line. Of course, her parents died earlier, but they had diseases that nowadays would be either treated with antibiotics. Phthisis pneumonia is tubercular pneumonia, tuberculosis. And her mother died of uterine carcinoma, which is preventable now with women getting their pap smears every year. So they died early, and who knows, you know, this is the Phillips line that goes back to the guy who was in the revolution, who was 100 and who many ancestors on various sides of that family lived well into their 80s and 90s, even 200 years ago. So some pretty good genes. Hopefully I got some of that.
Mm-hmm. Let's hope so. Okay. Any other questions? Sorry, Dick.
Thanks again for a very engaging and interesting talk.
So I just stop screening, and I'll go to host for screening. You got it, Barry?
I think so.
Great.
See Matthew's picture?
Yep.
All right, great. Okay, let's give Dr. Bowdish a round of applause.
Thank you.
Oh, and I just woke my dog up. Sorry about that, guys. Okay, let's keep moving here. All right, I've got a few announcements to make. The first is our youth programs. We'll be receiving entries for this year's Americanism Elementary School contest, the poster contest. Like last year, we'll post the pictures of the entries online. A little different from last year's, the board of directors will make the decision and forward the winning poster to the State Society for judging at the annual meeting on April 17th. We also have a couple of other youth award winners that we're proud to announce. The first is the Sea Cadet Outstanding Citizenship Award. Recently, compatriot Henshaw presented the San Diego chapter's Sea Cadet Outstanding Citizenship Award to get Cadet Petty Officer Second Class Miguel Aris Barlasan at his home with his parents, Michael and Marissa, and his brother, Maven Barcelan. Cadet Barcelan is an exceptional young man who plans to enter the U.S. Naval Academy after graduating from high school. We also have our JROTC Enhanced Program winner, and that is Cadet Master Sergeant Jessica Pham of Scripps Ranch High School. In an Air Force JROTC unit, CA-935, and is the winner of our enhanced program. Compatriot Gary Newton will present Cadet Pham her award at an in-person event. That will be scheduled in late April or early May. Both cadets, Barlasan and Pham, will compete with other cadets throughout California for the State Society Awards in their respective categories. Those winners will move on to compete at the national events just prior to the annual meeting for NASSAR. A point to note, we believe the California Society is the only state society to have a cash award for the outstanding Sea Cadet. So we're honored that Jessica is competing. And compatriot Newton, is there something you would like to mention about Master Sergeant Jessica? Sure.
About the program. Yes, I would really like to let everybody know that Jessica was an absolutely outstanding nominee from our chapter. Of course, her file went forward to the state, where she's going to compete with other, of course, nominees from other chapters. Brandon Villardi, who is our state chairman for the JROTC program, told me that there are also nominees before the state for consideration from Sacramento and Orange County. So as soon as I get information about the outcome of that state competition, certainly I'll let everybody know. Otherwise, I just wanted to mention, Barry, that I just this week also received from the San Diego Unified School District, from the Colonel Swan's organization, that there are 13 cadets that have been nominated for various awards. So we are going to be busy as the spring approaches as far as our awards for the cadets are concerned. Thank you. That's it.
Thank you, Gary. Okay, moving on. I want to announce that the SAR Patriot Research System has been updated to include all California Society members who have joined since 1984. The update includes the Patriot lineages for each of the members' primary Patriot ancestor. And if that member has supplemental ancestors, they're loaded in as well. You can search by national number, last name, first name, state societies, things of that nature. As you can see on the screen here, I took a look at George Key's Patriot ancestor and believe he is the same John Key as is my sixth great grandfather, who I have not been able to find any Patriot documentation. Now I think I do. So I'm going to be working on that as a supplemental. Also in at the upcoming State Board of Directors meeting held on April 17th, we will be voting on three bylaw changes. The first proposal is for bylaw 7, section 6, which changes the wording to clarify and remove superfluous words regarding life membership funding. The second proposal is for bylaw 2, section 3A, which adds annual chapter reporting to include non-cash assets in the financial report. These non-cash assets are items like flags, their poles, muskets, drum, podium, everything that currently have. The San Diego chapter has a non-cash assets well above the $5,000 threshold. So we'll be doing an inventory prior to next year's reporting. The third and final proposal is for bylaw 8, section 1G, and that's to increase notification by the state society for annual and special meetings from 20 days to 30 days. Gives us a little bit more time. The board of directors will be voting on those bylaw changes at the upcoming meeting on April 17th. Okay. Also to let you know that the 131st Annual Congress, National Congress, will be held in person from July 10th through 15th. It'll be a face-to-face meeting, barring any orders from Governor Jay Inslee and the Washington Department of Health. But by July, I'm hopeful, as everyone is, that we'll be able to have face-to-face meetings again. In the fall, our 146th Fall Board of Managers meeting is also going to be held in person on November 4th through 7th in Riverside at the Mission Inn. We hope that any members locally can join. I know I'll certainly be at the Mission Inn. It's a wonderful place if you haven't been there. And you can see a picture of it here. Other upcoming events, again, we have our next chapter meeting on Saturday, the 10th of April, which is 1 week earlier in the month than we usually do, due to a scheduling conflict with that board of board members' attendance at the State Society annual meeting, which is at the same time on the 17th. So we're moving up the membership meeting up 1 week earlier, but we're going to hold our board meeting at the same time on the 15th. All members are welcome to join us. We'll be discussing what we need to do prior to the annual meeting on the 17th. The California 146th annual meeting will be held via Zoom. Please reserve your space early. There are only 100 available spots on the Zoom license that the state has. Many of those are going to chapter board members. And let's see here. We will have our last chapter meeting before the summer break on May 15th. It is the third Saturday of the month. I hope that this is our last mandatory virtual meeting, although we will continue to broadcast meetings even if when we do resume in-person meetings, hopefully starting in August. And on Memorial Day, the San Diego chapter is planning to host a tribute and wreath-laying ceremony via Zoom, and we'll have participation from state societies and chapters from across the country. As we get further along in it, we'll have more information for you to then. And before we close, I would like to please ask for you and your families to say some special prayers for compatriot Fred Hall's wife, Bonnie, who has been recently diagnosed with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, which is a very treatable and very curable form of lymphoma, but it is gonna require a lot of heavy work with chemotherapy and things of that nature. So please, please keep the Halls in your thoughts. I do every day.
Thank you.
Okay, so in closing, since compatriot DeLong is not here, I will give us the benediction. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep in your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and the blessings of God Almighty be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Compatriot Hall, would you lead us in the recessional?
Until we meet again, let us remember our obligation to our forefathers who gave us our Constitution, Bill of Rights, an independent Supreme Court.
Thank you. Would you all please stand? Color guard, would you please retrieve the colors?
Hutton, Hut. Cooper, March. Mark time, March. Color guard, halt. Right, face. Retrieve the colors. Again, cut. About, face. Mark time, march. Forward, march.
This concludes today's meeting. Thank you all for attending, and I look forward to seeing you again next month.